This is the new M4 Mac Mini, probably the best value desktop computer you can get today. Honestly, it's amazing, and it only costs $600. For probably 95% of people out there, this is more than enough computer. But for someone like me, who mainly uses a computer to edit YouTube videos, is it enough? I mean, I don't edit feature films, I don't have crazy cameras, just your average YouTube videos. Will this computer be enough? Or would I need to step up to the M4 Pro version, which costs more than twice as much? Well, I got both, and I'm gonna test them to see if the M4 Pro is worth the extra $800. Let's quickly look at the specs of these two computers. Both are off-the-shelf models with no upgrades. The M4 version comes with a 10-core CPU, a 10-core GPU, 16GB of RAM, and a 256GB hard drive. The M4 Pro version comes with a 12-core CPU, a 16-core GPU, 24GB of unified memory, and a 512GB hard drive. Now, there's a ton of videos out there comparing the benchmarks of these two computers. I'm not going to do that. What I'm going to do is compare real-life use, doing what I normally do with a computer, edit YouTube videos. To test these machines, I'm going to be using Final Cut Pro, which is very optimized for the M4 chips. First up is general timeline navigation. I've loaded up my project, which is nothing crazy, but it should be enough to give these two machines a workout. In this project, I'm using a multicam clip in my main timeline with three video angles and an audio track. For video angles, my main angle is a 6K shot in Panasonic Vlog. The secondary angle is a 4K file, also shot in Panasonic Vlog, and an overhead angle shot on an Osmo Pocket 3 in DJI D-Log M color profile. All three clips have Rec. 709 conversion LUTs applied to them and some light color correction. My timeline consists of this multicam clip, screen recordings and B-roll clips, and quite a few effects, graphics and animations from MotionVFX, who is today's sponsor. I have background rendering turned off, and right before I ran these tests, I went ahead and deleted all render files just in case. Also, I'm screen recording all these tests, so theoretically, if you were to replicate these tests at home, you should get slightly better results. Let's start with the M4 Mac Mini. Simply skimming the timeline felt very responsive. I could move my skimmer anywhere in the timeline, hit play, and the project would start playing instantly. One thing I did notice though, is anytime I zoomed in and out of my timeline, the thumbnails and waveforms took a bit of time to load up. Also, trying to play back parts of my timeline with lots of layers and some more complex animations, I did notice a slight stutter in the playback. Nothing major, just a little choppy. Keep in mind though, nothing in this timeline is rendered. The M4 Pro, as expected, was flawless in timeline navigation. The waveforms loaded instantly, and I couldn't find any part of the project where the playback would stutter. The M4 Pro Mac Mini performed noticeably better than the M4, but the M4 did amazingly well too. For my next test, I used the same project, moved the playhead to the start, and played the entire project all the way through. In my experience, sometimes playing for an extended period of time can make a computer fall behind a bit, and playback starts to suffer. First, the M4 Pro Mac Mini. I was able to play the project almost all the way through without skipping a beat. I did notice towards the end, the scrolling timeline started skipping just a little bit, and the end screen animation, more than 8 minutes into this project, was not as smooth as it normally would be. But honestly, for a project like this, with no rendering at all, this is pretty impressive. The same test on the M4 Mac Mini did not go as good. The scrolling timeline started skipping less than a minute into the video, and Final Cut Pro started dropping frames as soon as there was any animation in my timeline. Then things got worse. Around a minute into the project, the scrolling timeline started to really fall behind, and almost every place where there was an effect or an animation added was almost unwatchable. Shortly after the 4-minute mark, I lost all audio. The timeline kept playing, but completely silent. Stopping and restarting playback did get my sound back. It didn't get better after that either. The playback was choppy, the scrolling timeline wouldn't keep up, waveforms wouldn't load. Basically, to play back a timeline like I have here, it needed to be rendered. I was expecting the M4 Pro chip to be better at this, but I didn't expect it to be this much better. Before we move on to my next test, I just wanted to take a minute to talk about today's sponsor, MotionVFX. If you watched any of my videos, even this one, you've seen their plugins in action. Need a cool transition for your project? MotionVFX has a ton to choose from. Need a simple, minimalistic title? MotionVFX got you. Basically anything you can think of, MotionVFX has a plugin for it. and no quality is given up on any of them. MotionVFX has an amazing team of people designing these plugins and making sure they function just as expected. Their free M installer tool makes installation a breeze. And what I found really helpful is when I switched computers, the M installer tool was super helpful when it came time to install my plugins on the new machine. All I had to do was download M installer and sign in. Every plugin I purchased for MotionVFX was right there, ready to be installed. Most plugins you can purchase individually and they're yours forever. Or if you need a lot of plugins like I do, a Design Studio subscription may be a much better option. For a reasonable monthly fee, you can have access to basically every plugin MotionVFX offers. You even get a couple of exclusives you can't get anywhere else like MCaptions. When it comes to Final Cut Pro plugins, MotionVFX is miles ahead of the rest of the pack. No one even comes close. Visit the MotionVFX website today for some amazing Black Friday deals. Now, let's get back to the video. Next, I tested the render and export speeds of both Mac Minis to see how much time, if any, I could save with a more expensive M4 Pro. First, I tried exporting an unrendered timeline to an Apple device's 4K preset. I use this export preset because it gives me an amazing quality export, and YouTube seems to process it the fastest. This exports my timeline in an M4B file using the H.264 video codec. The M4 Mac Mini exported this 8.5-minute project in about 12 minutes. The M4 Pro Mac Mini exported the exact same timeline, unrendered, using the identical Apple device's 4K preset twice as fast, exporting this 8.5-minute project in only 6 minutes. Once again, I expected it to be faster, but I didn't expect it to be twice as fast. Maybe rendering out this project would help the base Mac Mini perform a little bit better. Rendering this entire project on the more expensive M4 Pro took about 3 minutes. The same task took more than twice as long on the M4 Mac Mini, rendering out this entire timeline in 7 minutes and 38 seconds. Quite a bit longer, but hopefully it helps with the export times. Spoiler alert, it didn't. Exporting this fully rendered timeline took just as long on the M4 Mac Mini. The final time for this export was 11 minutes and 37 seconds. I was sure rendering the timeline would speed up this export. I even ran this test a few more times, and each time, the results are very similar. The M4 Pro Mac Mini, on the other hand, did export quite a bit faster with a rendered timeline. This 8.5-minute project exported almost twice as fast with a rendered timeline, finishing in just 3 minutes and 35 seconds. This is more like what I was expecting. Now, in the last few Final Cut Pro updates, Apple added a number of machine learning features that really take advantage of the neural engine in the new Macs. Both the M4 and the M4 Pro Mac Minis come with a 16-core neural engine, so for my next couple tests, I wanted to try a couple of these features to see how much difference, if any, there would be. First was smooth slow motion. With this, Final Cut Pro analyzes clips shot at regular frame rates and uses machine learning to make additional frames in between. And this actually works amazingly well. I tested this feature on a 10-second 4K clip shot at 24 frames per second, and I used smooth slow motion to slow it down to 25% of the original speed. The M4 Pro Mac Mini analyzed my clip in about 35 seconds. And playing this clip right after it was analyzed gave me nice, buttery smooth playback. The M4 Mac Mini also did really good here, taking only slightly longer. The same 10-second clip was analyzed in about 40 seconds. I wish I could say the same about playback. Without rendering this clip, playing it back did not go as well. It wasn't unwatchable, but still pretty choppy. For my last test, I wanted to test Final Cut Pro's brand new, shiny rotoscoping feature called the Magnetic Mask. With this mask, you select your subject, and Final Cut Pro automatically tracks and rotoscopes it. I tested this feature on a similar clip I used in the last test. The M4 Pro Mac Mini handled this really well. I was able to analyze, track, and rotoscope my 8-second clip in only 25 seconds. And just like before, the playback after was flawless. My base M4 Mac Mini struggled here. The same 8-second clip took over 4 minutes. I tried it again and got very similar results. Even my M1 Mac Mini could do this faster, so I tried turning off my screen recording and running the same test. Apparently, recording your screen while editing in Final Cut Pro makes a huge difference, at least in this example. I was able to analyze, rotoscope, and track the same 8-second clip quite a bit faster when not screen recording, doing it in only 32 seconds. But still, the M4 Pro Mac Mini did this task even faster while screen recording. So, is the M4 Pro Mac Mini worth the extra $800? Well, if you use it to edit videos, definitely yes. If you can afford to buy the M4 Pro, do it. It's way faster. But even though the M4 Mac Mini didn't do great on my test, I did push it to its limit. I'm upgrading from an M1 Mac Mini, and I haven't directly compared the two just yet, but the M4 definitely feels a lot faster. Is a comparison between the two something you'd be interested in? Let me know in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.